heart is the we. An individual is going deep within, according to his own perception, he discovers certain things. If we look at it here, there is a concept of macro and micro. The cosmos is macro. When the cosmos is compressed, it becomes micro and man is micro. Whatsoever is there in the cosmos is available in an individual. That's why mystics have gone deep within and discovered the outer realms. In inward journey, heart is the way. Heart or kalb. Heart is an English term, more or less referred to the biological aspect. Kalb is a spiritual aspect. Anything that you see, it has an esoteric and exoteric aspect. The esoteric aspect relates to the inner life, and exoteric is outward or relates to in one way we can say to the biological functioning. Love is the overflow when there is harmony within. Kalp is at peace or sukoon. Love is the fruition or ultimate in any kind of relationship, be it male-female or interaction with another person in whatever capacity it is. Therefore, your responsibility indeed is to the heart, not to the mind. Heart is the reality and mind is borrowed and illusory. It is the mind that creates illusions. And I have explained to you the four aspects of the mind. The mind in general, the inner space, and within that space there is ego sense, there is intellect, there is a storehouse of the memory, and all these, sum total of all these is known as mind. So no thought is yours, all are borrowed. Everyone in the world wants to be true and blissful. Remember, just to be true brings much joy and bliss. Then why should one be false? Yet still people continue to be false. You have to gather courage for a little deeper insight into it. Why are people, or in particular, why are you afraid? What can the world do to you? People laugh at you. People can laugh at you, you may wonder. And if they do so, it will do them good. Laughter is always therapeutic. It is medicine and healthy too. But we are concerned that people will laugh at me. People can think that you are mad. Remember, just because they think you are mad, do you really become mad? And we continue to live in the image of others because we have not discovered our innerness and we have not have the confidence in our inner self. If someone thinks about you something, allow them to think as they wish. Do not allow them to defile the sanctity of your heart. Whatever you think about me, that is your opinion. and your opinion does not matter to me as far as my inner self is concerned. There is no one who knows me more than I do. And if you are authentic about your joy, about your tears, about your dance, sooner or later there will be people who will start understanding you and may start joining your caravan. And this is what happens. Master discovers his own joy, own tears, own innerness, and sum total of this is inner flowering. When the flowering happens, the beauty and the fragrance spreads, bees gather, the flame is lit, many unlit flames gather around, then you can share your joy and blissfulness with your spouse or with anyone else that comes in your contact. And then its fragrance will spread. Like a flower, I blossomed alone on the path to the spring of inner joy. Like a flower, I blossomed alone on the path to the spring of inner joy. And then other flowers started blossoming, and lo, now the spring of blissfulness is all around. Like a flower, I blossomed alone on the path to the spring of inner joy, and then other flowers started blossoming, and lo, now the spring of blissfulness is around. The blossoming of the first flower indicates the arrival of the season of flowering, the season of spring. Blossoming in love is the indication of the arrival of the season of love. I have not invited anyone. I have simply done whatever I felt was coming from my heart. Flower has blossomed, and seekers gather around like bees to drink the nectar from this flowering. This happens to each one of us. All you need to do is allow the flower to blossom. Just as my responsibility is towards my heart, not otherwise, so is your responsibility only towards your being. And when you are responsible towards your being, the flower begins to blossom. Its fragrance and beauty captivates all around. Never go against it, because going against it is like committing suicide and destroying you. And what is the gain? Even if people give you respect and people think that you are very sober, respectable, honorable one, it does not matter. None of these things nourish your body. Instead, these nourish your ego sense or nafs. Why do I have to depend on the opinion of others? Why do I need respect from others? If I have respected myself, discovered my being, all these things become immaterial what others think of you. Because none of these things are going to nourish your being, also they are not going to give you any more insights into life and its tremendous beauty. And moreover, everybody is so concerned with their own problems, then who cares whether you are laughing or dancing? No one has time for it. It is only your mind that is thinking, that the whole world is thinking about you. Human mind is so crowded, worried with the stampede of thoughts about him, life and problems. You mistake to think the other has time even to look at you or think about you. No, indeed, no one has. You should not be worried at all. Everybody is so concerned with his own world, and no one has time or energy to bother about you. And even if they have some opinion, it is their problem. A wise man never bothers about the opinion of others. Alone you came in the world, alone you are here, and alone you will leave the world one day. Alone you came in the world, alone you are here, and alone you will leave this world one day. All their opinions will be left behind. And what really remains are your original feelings, your original face. That is why Zen masters emphasize to discover your original face, the face with which you were born. And it is your authentic, your original face represents your authenticity. It is authentic. And the experiences that will go with you even after your death. Death cannot take away your dance, your tears of joy, your purity of aloneness, your silence, your serenity, and your ecstasy. That death cannot take away from you. Death cannot take away from you all that is your real treasure. That is why we look at the word that is used in Buddhist terminology about death, nirvana. It comes from two words. Nir means without. Vana, it comes from the word vani. Vani means sound. A state where there is no sound. All noise has disappeared. Because of the noise, we are not hearing the constant humming that is taking place in the cosmos. There is a rhythm, there is a music happens. Just as you have your laptop, and when the laptop is turned on, there is a silent sound of its operation. But because we use laptop for other purposes, we do not hear that sound. In the same way, because of the noise of the mind, we fail to realize that there is a constant music generated as the things move in the existence. Death cannot take away your dance, your tears of joy, your purity of aloneness, your silence, your serenity, your ecstasy. That death cannot take away from you all that is yours, only real treasures, not the faults. How many millions of people have lived before you on this earth? You do not even know their names. Whether they ever lived or not does not make any difference. There have been saints and masters, there have been sinners, and there have been very respectable people, and also all kinds of crazy ones as well. And they all have disappeared with no trace remaining. Your sole concern should be take care of and protect those qualities which you can take with you when death comes. What you can take with you is your dance of ecstasy, tears of joy, purity of your aloneness, your inner silence, your serenity. It is only these qualities that are your real companions. They are only treasures, and people who attain to them, only they live while others pretend to live. Then your blessedness will spread in the outer atmosphere. And when this begins to spread in the outer atmosphere, it is known as the energy field. It is known as aura. It is known as light. It is known as tawajjuh. And those who are vulnerable to it, open to it, they imbibe that. And they too begin to transform. On the contrary, mind is a thinking process, a pattern. It is a continuous process of thinking. The thoughts, it's like a television that is never turned off. Its broadcast continues. Thinking cannot be stopped. This does not mean that thinking cannot be stopped, but all efforts to stop it fail. When it stops on its own. And indeed it stops on its own accord. You have to understand this. Otherwise you can go mad chasing your mind and trying to stop the flow of thoughts and thought sequence. You have to take a quantum leap to go out of the mind, to reach to the state of no mind. No mind does not arise by stopping thinking. When thinking is no more, no mind is. And how does this happen? You have a lit candle and you want to light another candle. What is the process? What is the process of lighting an unlit candle in the company of the lit one? You bring the unlit candle in the close proximity of the lit one. How much closeness it requires, no one knows. You have to bring it closer. A little closer, again a little more, then all of a sudden something jumps like a quantum leap, the invisible, which is not visible to the human eye, and something jumps from the lit candle and the unlit is lit low, the unlit one is lit. No one knows how does it happen. It's a quantum leap. Just in the close proximity it happens. In the same way, when mind comes in contact with an unlit, in contact with a mind which is a flame, mind which is a flame with aloneness, with silence, like a flame, it has blossomed. All of a sudden, like a quantum leap, something jumps from that state of no mind and reaches the mind and it disappears. The thought process disappears. And as soon as the thought process disappears, the mind comes to an end. Mind is no more a master, then instead it becomes a mechanism. And no mind is the rebirth of the mind or the second birth. In all the religions, all the tariqas, we have the emphasis on the twice born. Reborn, different words are used. Reborn, twice born. Initiation is a process of rebirth. You have lived your life up to now in a certain way. From now onwards, you are discontinuous with all that was known. Your identity that I am this, you are entering a new realm. And then what happens? You are given a new identity that I am the being, that you are the Noor. For this we use zikrs and all these things. And when this begins to consolidate in you, then your energy moves and flows through the heart center. Remember, heart is the way, not the mind. When heart is totally awakened to the cosmic presence, then you enjoy the fine and small things in life, and your mad chase towards the realm of non-essential comes to an end. You move in a totally different way. Every effort to stop the mind will create more anxiety and conflict. Also, it will make you split and schizophrenic. You will be in constant turmoil within. Certainly, this is not going to help in any way. And even if you succeed in stopping the thoughts forcibly for a few moments, it will be futile. Indeed, those few moments will be almost dead moments of your being. You may feel a sort of stillness, but there will be no silence. A silence which is dancing, not the silence of a graveyard. Remember, a forced silence cannot be silence. Underneath it, deep in the unconscious, the repressed mind goes on working and getting even stronger every moment. So there is no way to stop the mind. However, the mind stops, and that is certain. And certainly it stops all of its own accord. So what to do then? The only thing that you are required to do is watch, be mindful, but do not try to stop it. There is no need to do any action against the mind. I have heard a monk went early in the morning to the house of an householder and asked for the alms. Whatever they get, fruits, cooked food or anything, that is what they eat. And according to tradition, they have to only go at 5 doors. And if nothing is obtained from any of these 5 houses, they go empty-handed. Tradition does not allow them to go more than 5. The monk knocks at the door of an householder. A woman comes out and she asks the monk to wait and she will prepare the meals for him. The monk said, "It is okay, I will wait outside until you have the things ready." The woman goes inside the house and she found there was no rice and no flour to prepare the meals for the monk. She decided to go by the neighbor, but the neighbor was not there. The house was empty. So she decided to steal the flour and rice. She stole it, came back to the house, and prepared the meals and gave it to the monk. The monk took the food and he went on his way. On the way, when he was going, he saw a young boy walking on the street alone. A thought came to his mind that I am getting old and no one is there to take care of me. If I take this child, in the modern terminology we call this kidnap this child. He thought that if I take this child and brought him up as my own and give him my sanskars, then he will be able to take care of me when I grow old. These thoughts were coming. Then all of a sudden, he watched the flow of thoughts. He could not stop it, but he watched. He became mindful of that. He introspected. Where did he go? What did he do? And why such thoughts are coming to his mind which never came to his mind before. He realized that the only place where he went is the place of that householder and ate the food that the lady had cooked for him. He goes back to the lady and asks her, tell me, how did you prepare the food? Where did you get the ingredients to cook it? Because after eating, many kind of thoughts coming to my mind. The lady told him, when I went inside, I found there was no rice and no flour. So I went to the neighbor's house with an intention to ask for a little bit of these ingredients, but she was not there. So I had to take these items without her permission. Then monk realized the food that he ate there has created an impression in his mind. And because of that, this thought of stealing the child came to him. This would have not been possible for him to see unless he was able to understand, watch his mind and be mindful of it. The only thing you are required to do is watchfulness, but you cannot try to stop it. There are many scientific studies done on the effect of mindfulness and this state of the mind, because as such each thought is an energy. A man is sum total of energy particles. That is why when atom breaks, there is a great explosion. The energy is condensed. If you want to do something to stop the mind, in the first place, who will do it? Remember, you are the mind. It will indeed mind fighting against the mind itself. When people say that I am doing this, it is one aspect of the mind is doing and the other aspect of the mind is trying to stop it. Two sides of the mind, the objective and the subjective, are at war with one another. Instead, these two, objective and the subjective aspect of the mind, the left and the right brain, has to work in harmony with one another. So if you say that I am going to stop the mind, who is really going to do it? Remember, you are the mind. It will indeed be mind fighting itself. You will divide your mind into two, the objective and the subjective. One is trying to control over the other, or one is trying to kill the other part. Really introspect over it. Certainly this is absurd, it is a foolish game, it can drive you crazy, and that's why when there is too much thoughts and people are trying to stop the flow of thoughts, instead of stopping it, they become schizophrenic, divided. They become crazy. Therefore, never try to stop the mind or thinking. Instead, just watch the mind, become mindful. Allow it total freedom. Let it run as fast as it wants. But you do not try in any way to control it. Just be a witness. It is beautiful. Just be mindful. Mind is one of the most beautiful mechanisms. Science has not yet been able to create anything parallel to the mind. Mind still remains the masterpiece, yet complicated and tremendously powerful. It has so many potentialities. Watch it. Be mindful of it. Enjoy it. But do not watch like an enemy. Because if you look at the mind like an enemy, you cannot watch. You are already prejudiced and you are already against it. Being an enemy means you are against it, you are prejudiced. You have already decided that something is wrong with the mind. When you have already concluded, then there is no way to go on witnessing. Witnessing means you are neutral. You are non-judgmental. Witnessing is a state of innocence when there is no judgment. And whenever you look at something as an enemy, you cannot go deeper. You will never look into the eyes. You will simply avoid. What is meant by watching the mind? Watching the mind means you are looking at the mind with great love and reverence. Indeed, it is God's gift to you. Nothing is wrong in mind itself. Nothing is wrong in thinking itself. It is a beautiful process like any other process. Clouds moving in the sky looks beautiful. Then why not accept thoughts moving on the inner sky like clouds? Flowers blossoming on the tree looks beautiful. Then why not allow the thoughts flowering onto your being? You are not stopping it. Simply you are enjoying the thoughts floating onto the sky, inner sky. You watch their beauty. The river runs towards the ocean is beautiful, although it may deviate from its path along the way. Then why not this stream of thoughts? Then why not this stream of thoughts running elsewhere to an unknown destiny? Thoughts may get wavered, but ultimately these reach the being, the ocean. Every movement of thought is beautiful only when you are a witness to it. Only when you are mindful. Look with deep reverence. Never try to be a fighter. Instead, be a lover. Watch the subtle nuances of the mind. Watch its sudden turns, leaps and bounces. And the games and the mind goes on playing. The dreams that it weaves, the imagination, the memory, and thousands and one projections that it creates. Watch all these. The dreams that it weaves, the imagination, the memory, and thousands and one projections that it creates. Watch them all standing there aloof at a distance, not involved. By and by you will start feeling the disappearance of the mind. You enter into a new realm, which is the disappearance of the mind. The deeper your watchfulness reaches, in the same proportion your awareness deepens. With consciousness deepening more and more, gaps start arising and intervals too between two thoughts. One thought appears on the inner sky, and before another comes in, there is a gap, and this gap begins to increase. One cloud has passed, another is coming, and in between there is a gap. In those gaps, for the first time, you will get the glimpse of no mind. No mind is a space between two thoughts. You will have the taste of no mind. You can give this taste the name of Zen or Tao or Yoga or Satori or anything else. But the moment is magnanimous, and in those small intervals, suddenly the sky becomes clear and sun is shining in its full splendor. Suddenly the world that was full of misery has now dropped all the barriers. The screen on your eyes is no more there. With thoughts disappearing in the oblivion, eyes become crystal clear. You see clearly and penetratingly. The whole existence becomes transparent. In the beginning, these come just like rare moments, far and few and far, and in between as well. But they will give you a glimpse of what a state of fana is, what a state of samadhi is, what a state of saturi is. Like small drops of silence, they will come and they will disappear. But now you know that you are on the right track. You start watching a game. When a thought passes, you watch it, and then an interval comes. This too you watch. The interval to your watch. Clouds are beautiful. Sunshine is also beautiful, and now you are not choosing. This is why music has been created, to give you the state of no mind. A note is being played, and by the time the other note comes, there is a gap. You see the five fingers, but between the two fingers, there is a gap. This gap is more relevant than the finger. The peak and the valley both are important. Without the peak, the valley cannot exist, and without valley, peak has no value, no use. It is the fingers and the gap between the two fingers make the hand. Hand is fingers and the gap between the two. The gap is known by the term gap, and fingers by itself. Fingers are visible, but we become oblivious to the gap. When you do not choose, you watch the clouds appear and disappear. Now there is no fixed mind. To like only the intervals is a stupidity. Attachment only to the intervals is deciding against thinking. And then those intervals will disappear. Whatsoever you choose begins to disappear. They happen only when you are separate from them. They happen on their own. You cannot force them to happen. They are spontaneous happenings. Go on watching. There is no need to hold on to a particular gap. because the next gap will come in again after its thought has disappeared. Go on watching. Let thoughts come and go. Thoughts move freely. Nothing is wrong. Do not try to manipulate, and also do not try to direct it. Let thoughts move in total freedom, and then intervals will prolong. You will be blessed with small states of halls or satoris. Hal is a state of disappearance. It is a gap between the two processes of the mind. Sometimes it is elongated, other times it is short. You will be blessed with small such moments. Sometimes minutes will pass. Sometimes minutes will pass and no thought will be there. It will be like the dead of the night when there is no traffic. Instead, there will be total silence, undisturbed. This is meditation in the marketplace. When you stand at the busy corner and you watch the traffic, the people moving, the vehicles moving, a vehicle comes, after that there is a gap. No vehicle is passing that time. It will be like the dead of the night when there is no traffic. Indeed, there will be total silence, undisturbed. When the bigger gap comes, you will not only have the clarity to see into the world. Instead, with bigger gaps, you will have a new clarity arising, and you will be able to see into the inner world as well. With the first gap, you will see into the outer world. Trees will become greener than they look right now. And this process continues. You will be surrounded by an infinite music and bliss. You will be suddenly in the presence of God, both indefinable and mysterious too. This is what a state of trance is. From all around, God may be touching you, and you yet still cannot grasp it. Within your reach, and yet you remain beyond. With the gaps becoming bigger and prolonged, the same will happen inside. God now will not only be outside, and you will suddenly be surprised that He is inside as well. He is not only manifesting through the seen, but through the seer as well. He is both within and without. But do not get attached to that either. Attachment is the food for the mind to continue. Non-attached to witnessing is the way to stop the mind. Without any effort, it stops. And when you start enjoying those blissful moments, your capacity to retain them for longer periods, you can imbibe, once you begin to imbibe that silence, you can develop also simultaneously capacity to retain that silence for longer time. Then, like the dissolving notes of a sweet melody, it continues to enchant your being. You can retain them for a longer period. Eventually, one day you become the master. Then when you want to think, you think. If thought is needed, you use it. If thought is not needed, then you allow it to rest. Not that mind is simply not there anymore. There certainly mind is. The choice is yours to use it or not to use it. Just like legs or hands, mind is there. If you want to run, you use your legs, you use your feet. And if you do not want to run or walk, you simply rest. The choice is yours. The feet are not running on their own. It is running at your will and pleasure. Mind becomes that. There is no need to worry. Both hands and legs are there. If you are not running, that does not mean that the feet has disappeared. In the same way, mind is always there. When I am talking to you, I am using the mind. It is through an automatic process. The sentences are formed like a music, they flow. I am not choosing the words. It is happening spontaneously. When a sentence flows, it flows like a music. Music, I am simply connected to my being. The words begin to overflow from there like a stream, gushing out like a fountain that has now spurting water from its reservoir, continues to flow. The same way, the words begin to flow. There is no thought in it. When I am answering your question, I am again using the mind. Then too, there is no other way. I have to respond and relate. The mind is a beautiful mechanism. When I am not talking to you and I am alone, there is no need to use the mind. There is no mind. Remember, mind is a medium to relate through. Sitting alone, it is not needed. When you have not given it a rest, mind becomes mediocre. Continuous use makes the mind weary and dull, and this is what happens, and this is what confusion, this is what tension, this is what creates a situation that you say, I am very tired, I need rest. You are allowing the mind unceasingly continue. It becomes weary and dull. In the day you think and in the night you dream. In both cases, mind works. Day in and day out, it goes on working. If you live for 70 or 80 years, it will be continuously working. Look at its delicacy and the endurance of the mind. It is delicate. In the small head, all the libraries of the world can be contained, and all that has ever been written can be contained in one single mind. Tremendous is the capacity of the mind. In such a small space, all this is stored. Computers are there, but they are not yet minds. Mind acts as a computer, but computer cannot act as a mind. Computers are still mechanisms. They have no organic unity. Mind has an organic unity. Computers do not have any center as yet. And someday, if it becomes possible, it will be possible that scientists may someday be able to create minds. Then you will know how much space that computer will take and how much noise it will make. Mind makes no noise. It goes on working silently for 70 or 80 years ceaselessly. And when you are dying, your body may be old, but your mind remains always young. Its capacity remains yet the same. Sometimes if you have used it rightly, it even enhances with your age. Remember, the more you know, the more you understand, the more you have experienced and lived, the more your mind the more your mind becomes capable. When you die, everything in your body is ready to die except the mind. The body dies, but the mind lives on. In the East, we say mind leaves the body and enters another womb because it is not yet ready to die. The rebirth is of the mind and its conditionings, not that of the body. That's why we call Buddha's disappearance as Mahaparinirvana. He told Anand, on this particular day, I will enter into Mahaparinirvana. First, his physical body disappeared. He came back. That time, a man named Subhadra came running and he asked Anand that he wants to meet Tathagat Buddha. Anand said, Buddha have gone to enter into Mahaparinirvana. Buddha heard it. He said, I am still alive. My mind is still alive and I do not want that anyone came to Tathagat and Tathagat did not respond to the person. Let him come in. He has responded to him. And with this he gave the message. Even at the last moment, when someone is entering into death, he becomes completely aware. I recollect a particular incident. Lalaji and Chachaji both came from a caste lineage or caste. It is said Brahmins are higher and we need to bow down to the Brahmins, not the otherwise. So there was a particular person who was the cook and he came from the Brahmin clan. So he also became the disciple of Chachaji or Raghvardayal, the younger brother of Ramchandra Ji Allah Ta'ala Unnu. So Chachaji never allowed him to touch his feet. Anytime he tried to do, he said, no Pandit, you cannot. So when Chachaji entered into Samadhi, he was lying on the bed. He was sitting, he took Samadhi, entered into the cosmic realm while in the meditation posture. He was sitting cross-legged. Consciously he entered. So it was said that we can pull his hands and the feet together to put him to lie down. That particular Brahmin person, the cook, tried to hold on to his feet to pull him. And as he was going to touch the feet, a current ran into him and pushed him aside. I did not allow you to touch my feet while I was alive. How can I allow you to touch my feet now? Apparently, what kind of death was that? The physical body has died, but the mental body or the mind has not entered into death as yet. So Buddha, first his physical body disappeared, then his mind disappeared, and finally the being disappeared. And then the person totally dissolved, and that is known as Mahaparinirvana. Beyond that, there is no birth or rebirth. After that, the only possibility exists if one wished to appear out of his own free will in the form of light. Rebirth is of the mind, its conditionings, not of the body. Once you have attained to the state of no mind, there will be no rebirth. Then you will simply die and disappear in the thin air, just as a flame disappears and nobody knows where it has gone. And with death, everything will be dissolved, your body. In that kind of death, everything will be dissolved, your body, your mind, and everything. Only your witnessing soul, witnessing will remain. that is beyond time and space. Then you become one with the existence and you are no more separate from it. The separation comes from the mind. There is no way to stop it by force. Move lovingly with deep reverence and it will start happening on its own accord. You just watch and there is no need to be in a hurry. The modern mind is in such a hurry, it wants instant methods of stopping the mind. You can force the mind to stop by using chemicals, drugs, and again you are being violent with the mechanism. It is not good. It is destructive. This way you are not going to become a master. You may be able to stop the mind through drugs. And then drugs will become your masters and you will remain slave forever. You are not going to become the master. You have simply changed your bosses. You have indeed changed for the worst. Now the drugs will exert power over you. They will possess you. You will be addicted to them. Without them, you will be nowhere. Meditation is not an effort against the mind. It is a way of understanding the mind. It is a very loving way of witnessing the mind. Certainly, you have to be patient. The mind that you are carrying in your head has arisen over centuries, over millennia. Your small mind carries the entire experience of humanity. And not only the experience of humanity, has mind contained the experience of animals, birds, plants and of rocks as well. That is why when person gets angry, he grinds his teeth, which is a way of the dogs. In fact, it contains the experience of all that you have passed through. All that has happened up to now has happened in you as well. That's why I said man is a microcosm. In a very small nutshell, you carry the total experience of existence, the macro and the micro. You represent the Atma, entire cosmos in micro form. Your mind is aggregate of all the experience. In fact, to say it is not yours is not right. And in fact, to say it is yours also is not right. Instead, mind is collective as it belongs to all. Modern psychology has been approaching it, particularly Jungian analysis has been approaching it, and they have started feeling something like a collective unconscious. Your mind is not yours, instead it belongs to us all. Our bodies may be separate, but our minds are not separate. Look at the crowd. It acts and thinks one way. Our bodies are clearly separate. Human minds overlap while our souls are one. Bodies separate, minds overlapping, and souls are one. This is the process how it happens. My soul is not different than yours. At the very center of existence we meet and we are one. That is what God is, the meeting point of all. Mind is a bridge. Mind bridges the body and the soul between the world and the God. Instead of destroying it, understand and witness it. If you break the bridge, how can you reach from the circumference to the center? Mind is the bridge from circumference to the center. Many have tried to destroy it through the body postures and breathing that brings subtle chemical changes within the body. For example, standing on the head in the headstand, you destroy the mind very easily. Because in headstand, too much blood rushes like a flood into the hand. And you do not know what are you trying to do. The mind mechanism is very delicate. And you are flooding it with blood. The delicate tissues will die. That is why you never come across a very intelligent person who engages in these kind of stands. Standing on your head, you are forcing your blood into the head through gravitation. The head certainly needs blood, but in very small quantity, and that too slowly, not like a flood. Flood is against the law of gravitation. Very little blood reaches the head in a very silent way. This is natural and spontaneous. Too much blood reaching into the head, it is destructive. There are rhythms of breath, subtle vibrations of breath, which can be very drastic to the delicate mind. The mind can be destroyed through them. These are old tricks. Now the new tricks are LSD, marijuana and others. More and more sophisticated drugs are available, and more will be available sooner or later. Never try to stop the mind, instead watch it. To stop, it stops of its own accord. It's a beautiful when something happens without any violence. It has a natural growth. You can pull the petals of a bud and open it by force. On that you will destroy the beauty of the flower. Now it is almost dead. It cannot stand your violence. The petals will be hanging loose, limp and die. When the buds open on their own energy, on its own accord, then those petals are alive. That is a tremendous beauty. And beauty and the fragrance goes together. Mind is your flowering. Just watch the mind in deeper prayer, love and reverence, and see what happens. Miracle happens of their own accord. There is no need to pull and push. The natural transformation of the mind happens on its own accord, just like a bud opening its petals and dancing to the sun when it begins to shine early in the morning. The dew drops that has fallen onto the petals begin to shine in the glory of the sun. And nothing is wrong, even if immoral thoughts, so-called immoral thoughts, pass through your mind. Let them pass. There is nothing wrong. The wrong is your identification with such thoughts. You remain detached, no harm is going to be done. Allow its own way, and it will lead you by and by to the state of no mind. Watching ultimately culminates in no mind. No mind is not against the mind. Instead, no mind is beyond mind. No mind does not come by destroying the mind. Instead, no mind comes when you have understood the mind so totally that thinking is no longer needed and your understanding has replaced it. A journey from mind to no mind is the esoteric aspect of initiation. Up to now you had been living by your mind. Now you lived. This is a meaning. When it came to me, when I had gotten the problem with my feet, you have walked with your feet for too long. Now use my feet to walk. Now walk with my feet. When you come to the company of a sheikh or a master and you are initiated, indirectly he is telling you, up to now you have lived with your mind, your way. Now you live my way of the inner, the way of the being, the way of Ruh. And this is a new beginning, a rebirth. This is rebirth, a journey from mind to no mind, a journey from journey to reach to your center, your kalp, your heart center.